Dear colleagues, it's a true pleasure for me to present the first lecture because the presenter is one of my best friends and is one of the pioneers of pediatric laparoscopy in Europe. He started his career in Liège and he had two specializations in general and in pediatric surgery. Then he moved to United States and he spent 3 years at the University of Tennessee. This is one of the photos of this period. You can know young Tom Loeb and young Paul Philippe. He won some awards and he is a member of the most important association of pediatric surgery all over the Europe and also in the United States. He organized a lot of national and international meetings and published a lot of publication, a lot of presentation all over the world, and he is part of board on 7 national and international journals. He is one of the experts of the ERCAD, and this is one of the photos of Brazil of some years ago, and regularly he teach in Strasbourg, in Taiwan, and in Brazil. His current position is the chief of Department of Pediatric Surgery of the Hospital Center of Luxembourg, and as I told you, is one of the pioneers of pediatric laparoscopy. Ladies and gentlemen, Mr. Paul George Philippe.
Thank you very much, Ciro, for those words. I would like to sincerely say thank you to the ESPES and its board for inviting me and giving me this honor and privilege that I think I do not deserve, but we'll do what we can. Can I have the slides? Well, Mario Mendoza and Philippe Montupe asked me to discuss with you intravesical surgery, vesicoscopy. So I ask myself why there are people that are much more expert in the field than I am. And then I said, well, maybe because this is typically one of the interventions that reaches what seems the limit of minimal invasiveness. Now, as mentioned, my history in endoscopic surgery started in 1989 when I was a fellow at the University of Tennessee, and the chief was this man, and he came back from a meeting in Berlin. It was the first international meeting on pediatric endoscopy, the first IPEC meeting. And he opened, during the conference of the department, a kit of instruments that had nothing to do with what we were used. It was a telescope, fine instruments. And this is the reaction that everybody around the table had. We all thought that Tom Loeb must have gone mad. History proved that we were the donkeys. Now, as a baby surgeon, I thought that he was giving me some immunization, but in fact, he was just inoculating me with a virus that I would like to transmit to you. That virus is minimal invasiveness in endoscopic surgery. Now, what I'm going to discuss now is not something that I invented. The pioneers are C.K. Young and Jeff Valla, who will join you a little bit later this afternoon. Well, they share not only vesicoscopy in common, but they also work close to the sea in opposite parts of the world, in Hong Kong and Nizza. Now, I looked in the literature about the techniques that we are going to discuss, and amazingly, I only found 10 relevant papers in the last 5 years. Now, the technique is so enthusiastic. The people that have presented them, CK and Jeff, make it so easy that I could not understand why not more people are working on this topic. Now, the most common indication is reflux, vesico-ureteric reflux. And I think this is also a disease that calls us toward minimally invasiveness. Is the treatment of reflux necessary? Thoughts have changed, have evolved over the year, and nowadays we are working toward a minimally invasive diagnostic approach, and even the management is getting minimally invasive. So there remain few kids with recurrent infection or anatomical anomalies that the pediatrician will send to us. And if we discuss minimal invasiveness, let's not forget that cystoscopy and suburetic injection of whatever substance you like is extremely minimally invasive. It's quick, it's easy, it's a daycare procedure, and the best of us have 85% of reflux resolution. I wish I get that. It's not always possible to do that, and there will remain kids that need a formal operation. What can we offer them? Well, several ways. The most common are the Lisch-Grégoire extravesical approach and the Cohen transtrigonal reimplantation. Of course, today we are going to discuss their laparoscopic implementation. Now, I used to remove Ledbetter and Politano as within the minimally invasive operation, but what I found in April this year is that there are teams that are able to do Ledbetter Politanos by vesicoscopy. Now, why? Well, the cystotomy that is necessary for those operations is a painful operation. The kids often require high-level pain medications. Our anesthetists were used to put epidural catheter when we did open reimplantation. They suffer bladder spasm, they need oxybutynin, and in the long term, there are some suggestion that maybe the bladder scar could induce dysfunction, especially in young kids. So trying to find a way to do that minimally invasively is not really a toy, it's really a progress in the treatment of those kids. There are, in the literature, in the search period I did, many more hundreds of papers on the extravesical approach to vesico-ureteric reflux, the Lisch-Grégoire procedure in the field of laparoscopy, with the advantages of no opening of the bladder and no need for catheter. This technique has some limits. I think many will do it because it seems easier. Now, in our department, we try to be all-rounders, and we do that as well as intravesical reimplantation. And I can tell you that the claim that it is easier, in my eyes, is not correct. The dissection of the most lower part of the ureter is very difficult. Now, what you have just seen is one of the techniques that allows you to do a lot of things. It is suspension. Now, see, the dissection of that lower ureter and the creation of the tunnel is, I think, not easier behind the bladder than it is inside the bladder. Now, pneumovesicoscopy brings all the minimally invasive surgery difficulties in one tiny little room. The bladder has volume limited to about 60 milliliters in a one-year-old and not much more in all the kids. So you need to work to create some space to do the operations. Now, it is a three instrument operation. You might especially in girls, and the fourth one through the natural urethral axis. In infants, you will be able to have a very short table, because what you will need is both an access to the abdomen, ideally from the head of the patient, and to start the procedure, a cystoscopic access. In older kids, well, you will have to stand on the side, and that will be even more ergonomically wise complicated. Now, see, in a bigger, in an older child, we'll have to work bent forward, and the instruments will most of the time be extremely vertical, and at the end of the day, your shoulder, your neck, you will be a very good candidate for CIRO latest paper on musculoskeletal disorders. Babies, I think, are a little bit more easy, because you can comfortably sit them transversely on the table and have a very easy access and a very nice view together with your assistant. Now, of course, if you are going to work surgically, cut, burn, coagulate, you cannot do that under liquid, and you have to inflate the bladder with carbon dioxide. That's a problem, because around the trocars, through the urethra, you will have leaks. If gas enters the pre-vesical space, basically you are going to convert, because you will lose any kind of working space that you have. There are often little leaks through the urethra, and in fact, the lesson I learned is that when that happens, resist the urge to increase the pressure. If you increase the pressure, you open the urethra, it leaks more. Do not increase the flow. Just be patient, work in a limited space, and go ahead and do it. And the bladder is a cavity within the abdominal cavity. And when you try to inflate that cavity, you have to prevent the big one from inflating. So this is where bladder suspension and fixation to the abdominal wall becomes very necessary. Once again, we said that we want to minimize the trauma to the bladder. Oops, I'm sorry. Now, if you have modern equipment, a modern light source, a nice camera, and a good camera holder that will be able to keep the little field of a 3 millimeter telescope where it needs to be, the 3 millimeter telescope is what you need. In fact, we have never used any other one. So this is the set of instruments that is necessary. That's a very regular, standard 3 millimeter instrument laparoscopy set. The access to the bladder, first start by under cystoscopic guidance, suspending the bladder to the abdominal wall. The pioneers have suggested the use of balloon or umbrella trocars, inserted bluntly into the bladder, which I think is a significant trauma, and with that technique required closure, suturing after removal of the trocar, which was a big problem, because once the trocar is out, you don't see what you are doing. Now, the little tricks we have found is you need to fix the trocar properly. And to do that, a little piece of tubing will serve two goals. One, the suture that you will use will hold strongly, and two, it will prevent the trocar from slipping inside. Quite often, the trocar tends to slip inside and you cannot open or manipulate your instrument. And then to introduce them, go see what other minimally invasive specialists have at their disposal, and you will find in your radiology department needle, guide wires, and dilators. So this is a regular 3 millimeter trocar fitted with a 10 French or 8 vascular dilator and a guide wire. And then, to suspend the bladder, you can, if the abdominal wall is thin, just go through the skin, or this is an excellent technique and very easy to use in many other situations. You put a loop of monofilament in one needle, a thread in the other, and you can retrieve it even through 10 millimeters of fat. Now that's the introduction with the guide wire. We are on a distended bladder, and basically, don't forget that the size of those instruments is the same as most suprapubic catheter that you would insert. So the trauma to the bladder wall is extremely minimal. And then fix it with a suspension thread, they won't move anymore. Now, the position of the trocar is extremely important. You work in a small space, so if you are wrong to start with, you will not achieve it. Of course, the camera is in the midline. And the easiest mistake to do is to put the instrument trocar too laterally, because it will slip along the bladder, enter the bladder here, with the urethra meatus here, no space to work. So they really need to be put on the anterior wall on the bladder, not too far from the midline. Now, initially, I tried to put the first trocar through the umbilicus. It's in a very bad position. You need to be at the dome of the bladder. You know where that little bubble is when you do a cystoscopy? And the instrument trocars should certainly not be in the line of a phalangeal incision. They would be very close to the urethra and you cannot work. Now, it is a natural tendency to put them here because you are always afraid that you will have to convert. Now, Steve Rottenberg, in a course, said this: if you want to put yourself in the ideal position for a conversion, you will be in a very bad position for the endoscopic procedure you intend to do, and you will certainly need to convert. So put yourself in the position to succeed with the endoscopic procedure. Now, I'm sure many of you have seen those videos from other surgeons, but you can see that the dissection of the meatus is fairly easy, and there is very little bleeding. I think the small counter pressure of the carbon dioxide is enough to release, to relieve some of the venous bleeding. And you can see that this is a double ureter because the technique is quite useful. If necessary, the first stitch will close the hiatus, and if necessary, you will mobilize both ureters. One of the most technically challenging parts is the tunnel creation. Why? Simply because you cannot bend your instrument to have them in line and have them come from both sides in the same line. But you can usually finish. And now the scary part is the suturing technique. And I'll give you a couple of tricks later on how to suture in a small, tiny space. I'll give you one trick at the end of the meeting. Beware that whenever you use the suction device, you lose your space. Now, with this technique, in simple reimplant, I leave a bladder catheter till the morning of the day after, of the second day after the surgery, and the child goes home on the second day after the surgery. Now, we have, Luxembourg is small, we have done 55 patients. And what I want to point out is that reflux, benign reflux, has become a very little minority of the kids that come to operation. We have Hutch diverticulum, duplex system, ectopic ureters, ureteral seal, big, ugly dilated ureter. That's the one that we have. The nice, easy reflux, pediatricians keep that for them. So how does it work for those cases? Now, for ureteral seal, I'll just show you two little videos. Now, this one is the nice one. That's a simplex system ureteral seal. And in fact, it was quite easy to dissect it around, isolate the ureteral seal and mobilize the ureter. And then close the bladder wall. This is a 4-0 Vicryl. One difficulty, put the needle through the trocar. I use ski needles fairly straight so that they can go through the trocars. And you can very precisely close the bladder floor. Now, to resect the specimen, that's when, in a girl, a forceps through the urethra comes handy. And the rest is regular submucosal tunneling and enclosure. Now, the most common are duplex system, and they are often much more difficult. This is a girl that had a neonatal incision and ended up with reflux in both ureters over duplication. And here the dissection is much more difficult. The plane between the ureterocele, the urotelium, and the back wall is extremely thin. There is basically no backing behind the ureterocele. And you will enter the ureterocele quite easily. And I want to show you that nothing is, not everything is pink. Okay, there we go. There's a hole in the vagina. But I'm not going to say no big deal, but we know how to suture and we know how to close it. And there again, we can repair the floor of the bladder up to the neck with fine suturing in one or two layers. Megaureters, that's another issue. One of my son is a mathematician, so he told me that I should write Packing's law this way. The length, for any length of tunnel that is greater than four times the diameter of the ureter, then the probability that you have reflux after is less. So we need to have a long tunnel, at least a tunnel long enough to accommodate the diameter of the ureter. We cannot increase the length of the tunnel. So what we will have to do is decrease the diameter. Now, you can see the dissection, and you can see that it is not always as clear and as neat. It's always wet. The telescope fogs, the smoke accumulates in the bladder, but with a bit of patience, you end up dissecting 8 or 10 millimeters of ureter without not too many difficulties. And you can reset the part that you don't want. Now, this is another example of a child that had a deflux injection that turned out to be obstructive, and you will see some deflux particle coming out, see on the hook there. There again, after mobilization, well, the technique is to do a remodeling. You can, through the urethra, pass a 10 French catheter, and then reset the ureter, and do fine suturing. The catheter itself is an excellent hand to manipulate and present the ureter properly so that you can do a nice running suture or whatever you want, and then implant them. In all those difficult re-implantation, we have used double J stents at the end of the procedure, not for simple reflux. Now, if sometimes you run into trouble you don't expect. In a boy, you want to tie the resected ureter, it doesn't come out. So what should you do? What can you do? Well, cut it in little pieces and attach the little pieces one to the other. I call this technique the choo-choo train technique. These are long operations. Well, not necessarily for benign reflux. The latest one we did was in fact 90 minutes. That was grade 3 simple reflux with a small Hutch diverticulum. We did have a few complications. At the beginning, the most common was that the urethral catheter would slip inside, slip up the ureter. And if we converted it once, well, in fact, it is quite possible to use those little lasso that the interventional radiologists have, insert the scope in the ureter and catch the tube minimal invasively, excuse me, with the lasso. Only one of the anastomoses in a double system had to be redone immediately because it was not catheterizable. And one of the very first kids had a bladder laceration. We changed the technique of insertion to what I showed you. We have had no bladder dysfunction. Every kid just peed right away once the catheter was removed with no pain, no urinomas. basically no hematurias after 2 days, and absolutely no wound problem, no wound infection, no nothing. So the length of stay was very small. In reflux, kids with bladder flow repair remained longer in the hospital, and what was the most remarkable achievement, paracetamol alone is sufficient in most of the case. As a rescue, you can add a little anti-inflammatory drug. No one required more than stage one pain medication. I'll skip this. Now, what about the follow-up? Well, if you are in a minimally invasive mind, the follow-up should be minimally invasive. Pioneers have shown that it works. So for simple reflux, we evaluated by cystogram, that's X-rays, that's catheterization or suprapubic tap, that's invasive, only the case with recurrent infection. And in fact, in all of that, only three or four of them came back, and all of them had normal cystograms. Now, for specific cases, probably it's wise to check what you have done. Now, this is a reflux in ureteral seal that we treated. And the result was no reflux, a minor diverticulum, and a contralateral reflux, fortunately asymptomatic. Megaureters, especially refluxing, are even more difficult. Well, one of them, we started from here, and we arrived there in a child that is asymptomatic. Here, in fact, the mistake was that because there were two ureters on this side, I tried not to taper, not to remodel the right side, and that was a mistake. Now, I'm less satisfied on the evolution of the dilatation of those kids. We know in open surgery that it is not easy. But as you can see, four of them have had a poor result on the dilatation. We try to dilate them and insert JJ stent for long term. It worked on only one in three. But the one that we decided finally to redo, well, we did it by minimally invasive. That's a Lish-Hegwa procedure type, sort of, where we would reset, divide the ureter at the part that is stenotic on the bladder wall, create the Lish-Hegwa tunnel, that's a resection of the stenotic part. I think it is mostly ischemia. And then you can reanastomose the ureter, just a little bit of suturing. The truth is, it's extremely difficult to get that suture done. Now, one trick to close the tunnel, I like to pass the needle from one side to the other of the ureter and not lift the ureter up. In a case like this one, it was impossible to lift it up, it was too scarred, but it's also a minimal mobilization of the ureter, and we added a psoas hitch in order to have a very long tunnel. Some have done bladder neck surgery. It is possible, I have no experience, and they have the same result in urogenic bladders. Bladder neck surgery is not very efficient. And another very, very good indication is bladder diverticulum. Now, the largest experience is from one of our member, Antonio Marte. We had one case, and you see, it's not small diverticulum. And that's another endoscopic lesson. Check that the recording is on when you do this type of operation. So, this procedure has an amazingly easy postoperative course for the children. Kids have barely any pain. That's not true for the surgeon. But when you come in the next morning and the child is up and around, running in the lobby, in the playroom, you forget your shoulder and neck pain. The results are similar to, once again, there are thousands of kids with conventional repair, and we will not match those numbers before we can say that it is equivalent. Now, the cosmetic result, well, we dismiss it as being irrelevant, but for the kids, I had parents showing me their scar and being so happy that their kids could have this. Now, these are very long operations. They are technically and physically challenging. The ergonomics cannot be worse. So you don't need to be patient, you need to be stubborn to get them done. And there is a question of reproducibility. So few teams seem to have embarked on this. Now, that's the anesthetist during the long procedure. I learned yesterday that the world famous climber, Messner, said in an interview that he did not understand why not everybody would climb to the top of the Everest. Thank you, Holger. Well, I also found this picture. This is Platini, that's my generation, putting Spain out of its misery on a free kick. And you know why Platini was so good at free kicks? Because he did this in practice. And we have the opportunity to do the same. That's what we call simulation. Now, I think people of my generation, it was easy because we were inventing. Now, there are courses, lab work, in which you can practice this. And I suggest that before you climb the Everest, why don't you take a little walk in the hills of the Luxembourgish Ardennes? What I mean is that if you want to be minimally invasive, you have to be 24/7. Maybe not to this point, but check for the testes by laparoscopy. If you have to run the bowel looking for a medial diverticulum, do it by laparoscopy. Gallbladder, appendix. I recommend that you do your appendicectomies with three trocars, because you will practice dissecting, mobilizing, using the instruments. And then you will move on to the spleen, resections. If you embark in doing hernias, that's an excellent way to do knots in small environment every day of your practice. Pyeloplasty is probably the best fine suturing operation that is very well codified for you before you embark on vesicoureteric reimplantation. Now, this is Vital, the horned mascot of our clinic, the horned surgeon of our clinic, and this is the conclusion, and I thank you for your attention.
Sorry, may I make a comment and question?
Absolutely.
Okay, thank you for your presentation. I would like to make a comment on the for the patient having both diverticular and the reflux. Diverticular and the reflux. When we just do pneumoscopic operation in such patients, we mostly as a surgeon sometimes forget that we are just only in the intervesical zone and we forget the extra vesical area. So if you just do the pneumoscopy and the patient has a big paraureteral diverticular, sometimes you may harm, during the dissection, you may harm the vascular and nerve structure, especially the gap vessels,
because we already closed that zone. So I just wanted to make this comment. My question is, do you have any experience or any comment about radio surgery?
Radio.
If you need a radio, then well, do you have any experience?
One comment about diverticulum. Yes, you're right. Don't forget that there is something behind. Now, amazingly, when you have air in front of the bladder, you lose your space. But it seems that behind the bladder, it doesn't bother the rest of the operation. Now, when we did that diverticulum, for which I don't have video, at one moment, we're pulling on the mucosa to pull it out, and there was that nice little spaghetti in the middle of the field. That was the vast difference. So there are plenty of precautions to take. We had no problems with little hutch or significant hutch around the reflux in the aorters. The second question was?
Redo cases.
Okay, we have never redone any of our cases, but I had one nice little girl who had a Lisch-Grégoire procedure elsewhere, and in fact they missed that it was an ectopic ureter. So she was refluxing, having a narrow segment in the tunnel, and then a reflux up. In that case, we were able to open up the bladder, free the ureter, reconstruct the ureter, and re-implant it this way. Thank you.
Paul, you were great as usual, and on behalf of Richard Wolf Company and of Amulya Saxena, who organized this support, it's a pleasure to give you the certificate of the Wolf Company for your wonderful conference. Thank you very much.